Hi, these are the top 20 films of 1979. When I say top, I mean my personal favourite films. Cheers. In at number 20, Mad Max. My favourite Mad Max films are the even-numbered ones, but this original low-budget Australian dystopian action revenge car movie is super cool. I've never quite known why he's known as Mad Max, though. He seems quite level-headed to me. Mel Gibson, on the other hand. In at number 19, The Muppet Movie. This first Muppet movie is one of the best. I don't know why I get such pleasure from seeing the Muppets walk. The film is full of cameos, some of which are hilarious, such as Steve Martin's pissed off waiter.
That'll be all for now.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
While others are simply cameos for the sake of cameos. Look, here's Elliot Gould. All right. In at number 18, Vengeance is Mine, a fascinatingly nasty film. The non-linear storytelling makes this tale of a serial killer absolutely captivating. The murders are horribly believable, clumsy and violent. Ken Ogata is brilliant as the lead, a man with a history of violence and no future ahead of him. In at number 17, Phantasm. This is such an odd horror film. It's very violent, but has a kid as the protagonist, and we follow him trying to stop the Tall Man, an undertaker who is turning the dead into zombie dwarves that can be used as slaves on his planet. It also has this musical number in it. In at number 16, The Jerk. A remarkably silly film. Steve Martin plays a thicko brilliantly, and Carl Reiner's comedic direction is spot on.
This is the kind of music that tells me to go out there and be somebody!
But Nathan...
Let him go.
Stanley Kubrick loved the film, and it led him to write Eyes Wide Shut with Steve Martin in mind to play the lead. Just try and imagine that.
May I have the password, please?
Is it getting hot in here?
Now, get undressed.
Come here, boy! Marie! 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 Where are you, Marie?
In at number 15, Stalker. Tarkovsky marvelously creates an eerie mood in this miserable science fiction film. Not a lot happens in the 2 hours and 40 minutes, but the world we enter is simultaneously completely recognisable as our own and also totally alien and unsettling. Truly a film like no other. In at number 14, Kramer vs. Kramer, the quintessential divorce movie. Meryl Streep and Dustin Hoffman are both fantastic as Kramer and Kramer. Justin Henry is equally good as their son they are fighting over. Streep in the movie is often shown to be the one in the wrong, but that was anything but the case on set. Before the first scene they shot, Hoffman hit her to get a better reaction. And as he was method, he would hurl insults at her and even call her John Cazal, the name of her recently deceased boyfriend. He also smashed this real glass against the wall without telling her. The thing about that, though, is that you can see him move the glass back to do it. Yeah, really spontaneous, Dustin. If you can ignore the backstage drama, the drama on screen is excellent. In at number 13, 10. It's only this high up on the list because I love Dudley Moore and I think this is his best film performance. Here he plays a wealthy composer going through a midlife crisis. He becomes obsessed with a young woman after watching her get married. After a huge dental procedure, he gets hammered and follows her to Mexico, where she has gone on her honeymoon. His drunk acting is second to none. In at number 12, The Warriors, one of the coolest movies ever made. Walter Hill's cult picture follows a gang desperately trying to get from the northern Bronx to their turf in Coney Island, while all the gangs in the city hunt them down. The soundtrack is amazing, and it's full of iconic moments.
Warriors, come up to play!
In at number 11, Camera Buff. This wonderful Polish film is charming, tragic, and funny in equal measure. One day in a depressing town, two new things enter a factory worker's life. his first child, and an 8mm film camera. The new camera changes his life more than the baby does. It opens up possibilities and becomes a hobby, a career, and later an obsession. Krzysztof Kieślowski was a wonderful director, and here he made an incredibly human film filled with beautiful details and great performances. 1979 was a great year for film, and here are some other notable releases. David Cronenberg's The Brood. You've got body horror, murderous little child monsters, and Oliver Reed. What's not to like? There were two Dracula movies, the underwhelming Frank Langella one, which does have a wonderful John Williams score though, and Werner Herzog's remake of Nosferatu, starring the monstrous Klaus Kinski as the famous bloodsucker. We had solid thrillers in The China Syndrome and Escape from Alcatraz. Star Trek the Motion Picture struggled to stretch a story for an episode into a feature. It takes Kirk about 15 minutes to board the bloody Enterprise. I still like this film though, aside from the horrible outfits. There was the brilliantly surreal The Tin Drum, about a boy who doesn't age and has one hell of a scream.
Oscar!
And who can forget Zombie Flesh Eaters, Fulci's superbly horrid horror where a zombie fights a shark. And now my top 10. In a number 10, Quadrophenia. This has to be my favourite film adaptation of an album, right up there with, Tommy, I guess. This is not a musical though, and the Who don't appear. What we get is a brilliant Mods vs. Rockers coming of age picture. Phil Daniels plays a young rebellious mod. He's perfect in it. And watching his awkwardness, his anger, and his disillusionment all hits home. I wasn't alive in 1960, but there are so many scenes in this that remind me of my youth and early 20s, especially as so much of it takes place in Shepherd's Bush, where I must spend a lot of time. Quadrophenia was also Sting's film debut. 6 years later, he and director Frank Rodham would reunite for The Bride, where Sting plays Frankenstein, who puts together bits of corpses and somehow makes the beautiful Jennifer Beals.
I sewed you together out of corpses.
In a number 9, Heartland. This is one of the great forgotten movies. A brutal and stark portrayal of life in the West. You can see why it wasn't a huge hit. Hey honey, what do you want to go see tonight? A film about a woman who moves to Wyoming to work as a cleaner and struggles to survive a tough winter while living with an emotionally distant man played by Rip Torn. Or would you rather go see Rocky 2? Conchetta Ferrell plays the lead character, based on the real-life homesteader Eleanor Pruitt. She is most known today for her role in Two and a Half Men, not Eleanor Pruitt, Conchetta Ferrell. Ferrell passed away last year, and it's a shame that this film is not more well known, as she's great in it. It pulls no punches, and there's no romance to this Wild West. The film is a depressing watch, but it's also a tender portrayal of people looking out for each other in the toughest of situations and environments. In a number 8, Scum. Another laugh a minute. This is a tough and vicious look at life in a borstal. Ray Winston, in one of his first film roles, is outstanding. When he first arrives, he just wants to get through the time he has to serve, but he is bullied by the daddy. When he finally gets revenge and asserts himself as the inmate in control, it's spectacular but horrible.
Wet bench, you bastard! I'm the daddy now. Next time I'll fucking kill you!
We root for him, but soon find out that he is just as bad as the previous daddy. He's a racist and a bully. The rest of the cast is also excellent, and it's so upsetting watching them go through what they're put through. It's uncompromising. Scum feels a lot like A Clockwork Orange in the way it deals with violence and the brutal punishments given to the young offenders. Unlike A Clockwork Orange, though, there isn't any visual flair or exciting classical music. Here, it is colourless and miserable. There's no music, only the counsellors shouting and the sounds of fists hitting skulls. Setting it in winter, the borstal feels like a gulag. It's so, so grim, but a wonderful movie. In a number 7, Breaking Away. This has to be one of the most charming films of the 1970s. This brilliant coming-of-age drama follows four teenagers in a small stone-cutting town in Indiana. The people who go to the university in the town call the locals cutters. And the four cutters that we follow are in constant conflict with the privileged students. One of the privileged bastards is played by Hart Boscher, who would go on to play the arsehole of all arseholes, Ellis, in Die Hard.
Hans. Bobby.
The four leads are fantastic. Daniel Stern, Jackie Earle Healy, Dennis Quaid, and stealing the show is Dennis Christopher, as the Italy-obsessed teen who loves nothing more than to cycle. His relationship with his father is particularly funny.
You are numero uno, King Papa.
Don't do that.
No, I have to take a shower.
It's a brilliant film about the have and the have-nots, the dreams of the young, and coming to terms with one's lot in life. It's a funny film with a brilliant take on friendship and family. It also makes cycling look like the greatest thing in life. It's a good-looking film, especially the scenes at the abandoned quarry, and it's full of joy. You can't help smiling as the film goes on, despite the fact that it has this touch of tragedy in the background at all times. It's amazing that a film set in a small town in Indiana with cycling at its heart is this wonderful. In at number 6, Monty Python's Life of Brian, one of the great comedies of the 70s. A man named Brian is born on the same day as Christ and is mistaken to be the Messiah. Graham Chapman is once again marvellous as the lead. He was the maddest of the Pythons in real life, but was so good at playing the straight man and grounding the films. His alcoholism was out of control in the 70s, but he was so eager to play Brian that he sobered up in time for filming, and was even the on-set doctor, having trained at St. Bartholomew's Hospital Medical College before turning to comedy. Thank God he was sober for this movie. It would have been terrifying if he'd been the doctor on the set for the other Python films. All the Pythons are hilarious in it.
Now look, no one is to stone anyone until I blow this whistle. Do you understand?
Brian, sir.
Brian, eh?
No, Brian.
Ow! Well, if it's not a personal question, are you a virgin?
If it's not a personal question, how much more personal can you get? Now piss off!
And the bison shall be huge and black, and the eyes thereof red with the blood of living creatures.
A really funny movie.
I'm sorry, a bit of a hurry. Can you go straight out? Line on the left, one cross each. Now.
In a number 5, Manhattan. This comedy and love letter to one of the greatest cities on earth is a real treat. It's typical Woody Allen fare from this period. It's funny, involves a fair amount of affairs, and has a neurotic energy to it. What sets this one apart, though, is its cinematography. Gordon Willis makes Manhattan look as good as it ever has. This is his greatest achievement, and that's saying something, as his work on Pennies from Heaven and the Godfather movies is extraordinary. Accompanying these gorgeous images is the music of George Gershwin, and they make wonderful partners. It could very well be Allen's best film. It's certainly his most beautiful. The cast is fantastic. Diane Keaton.
Yes, you're someone I could imagine having children with.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, hit the lights.
The underrated Michael Murphy.
I mean, we're just people. We're just human beings, you know? You think you're God. I gotta model myself after someone.
Mariel Hemingway.
You have to have a little faith in people.
And Meryl Streep in her second difficult divorcee role of 1979.
I came here to strangle you.
Nothing I wrote was untrue.
What do you mean? That book makes me have to be like Lee Harvey Oswald.
It's an honest account of our marriage.
An ex of mine got in contact with me and said she'd just seen Manhattan and that Woody Allen reminded her of me. I don't think it was meant as a compliment. In a number 4, Being There. Peter Sellers was one of the greatest comedic actors of all time, but he wasn't in many great films. This and Dr. Strangelove are his two masterpieces. Hal Ashby's satire is a brilliantly odd film. Sellers plays Chance, a simple-minded gardener who has spent his whole life working for a rich man, never leaving the house, and only learning about life from TV. When the old man dies, he is thrown out into the world. By chance, he ends up becoming a political pundit, considered a genius by all. Sellers is brilliant in it. In the words of Robert Downey Jr. in Tropic Thunder,
"Everybody knows you never go full retard."
But Sellers pulls it off. He does so little, but it works fantastically, and he is hilarious in it. It's a quietly silly film, but also has a lot to say. how a well-dressed, well-spoken white man can make it in a world with literally no intelligence needed.
A lot of gardening here.
We certainly do. Yes.
It's for sure a white man's world in America.
It is.
It also deals with life and death. Chance doesn't understand the death of his employer, but later in the film you see in his eyes him start to understand the finality of death. And it's heartbreaking. The supporting cast is great. Melvin Douglas plays a sick millionaire who sees Chance as a great business mind, and Shirley MacLaine is perfect as his wife, who falls madly in love with Chance. There isn't really a sex scene, but the scene where they are intimate together is one of the strangest and funniest in film history. The ending of the film is puzzling and powerful. It's quite overwhelming and leaves you thinking about the picture and the last shot long after you've seen it. The blooper reel tagged on at the end does take away a little of this impact, and Sellers was rightly furious when he saw that they had added it. Ignoring that though, this is a fantastically funny and tragic film. In at number 3, All That Jazz. Bob Fosse was such an astonishing director. Here he tells a warts and all semi-autobiographical film that also deals with his own death. Roy Scheider plays the Fosse-inspired choreographer and director. He's an egotist, an arsehole, a womanizer, a bad father, and an alcoholic. He is struggling with heart problems while trying to edit a film about a stand-up comedian and choreograph a new Broadway musical. 5 years earlier, Fosse himself suffered a heart attack while editing Lenny and staging the first production of Chicago. Fosse's films always look marvelous and have terrific editing, and this is no exception. As Scheider's health deteriorates, he begins to hallucinate musical numbers. It's macabre and tremendously entertaining. Fosse would die of a heart attack 8 years later at the age of 60. It makes this film even more fascinating. Who else has made such a self-deprecating feature film obituary about oneself? Stanley Kubrick said it was the best movie he had ever seen. High praise indeed, and totally earned. All That Jazz is amazing. And now for the top two films of 1979. Both of these films are two of my favourite films of all time, and it's very hard to say which is better, and it constantly changes. But today, in at number 2, Apocalypse Now. Francis Ford Coppola made 4 films in the 70s, and each one was a masterpiece. This is his largest, maddest, and most ambitious film. Here he adapts Joseph Conrad's novella Heart of Darkness, but he moves the story from the Congo to the Mekong Delta in the height of the Vietnam War. Martin Sheen is tasked with journeying down the Mekong River to assassinate the renegade Colonel Kurtz, who's lost his mind, murdered Americans, set himself up as a god, and has seemingly been eating a lot. Marlon Brando may be large, but his screen presence is enough to justify his casting. His intensity is spellbinding. War films often tend to focus on the tragedy of war, and fair enough, but here we have the chaos and madness of it. The journey down the river and into insanity is brilliantly captured. The making of the movie was as crazy as what happens on screen, and this seeps into the movie. You can tell that these people are really losing their minds. Martin Sheen gives his best performance as a broken man who has lost his morals. The crew of his ship are also fantastic, including a young Lawrence Fishburne. It's an episodical film, but each of these episodes are spellbinding. The helicopter attack on a Vietnamese village in particular stands out. And Robert Duvall is on top form as a surf-obsessed colonel. The soundtrack is unbelievably good. Well, Vietnam War films do have some of the best tracks of all time to pick from. The film is gorgeous, and Vittorio Storaro's cinematography is stunning. It's an overwhelming film. It's mad, it's beautiful, it's scary, it's full of hate and wonder. It's a filmmaker losing his mind, but also putting everything he's got and can get on screen. It's a film like no other and a complete mental masterpiece. And in at number 1, Alien, one of the great science fiction and one of the greatest horror films of all time. Ridley Scott's second movie transcends the typical monster picture. This is a wonderful example of the collaborative nature of cinema. Dan O'Bannon's terrific script, an excellent cast, iconic set design, remarkable special effects, a beautiful score, and top-notch direction makes this one of the great big-screen experiences. The alien itself is so well-known now, and such a part of pop culture, that it's hard to imagine what it must have been like to see this for the first time in the cinema. When I was a kid, I had alien toys and knew the life cycle of the xenomorph before I knew how people procreated. The mystery of Alien is one of the reasons why I love the film so much. and one of the reasons I dislike Prometheus. The space jockey and the alien spaceship having no explanation makes the film much more fascinating. You and the crew of the Nostromo don't know what you're dealing with. The crew is made up of great actors. Ian Holm, Tom Skerritt, Veronica Cartwright, Harry Dean Stanton, Yaphet Kotto, John Hurt, and Sigourney Weaver are all perfect in it. They feel like real people. They may be in space, but they're simply trying to get through the working day. They all feel equally important to the film, so we don't know who will die next. Ripley isn't the protagonist, and so when she's the final survivor, it makes that final fight even more terrifying. Jerry Goldsmith's score is lovely, melodic, and even creepy. Aside from the music, the sound design is truly great. The film is beautiful to look at, and inspired by the used universe look from Star Wars, it takes it even further. The special effects are spectacular, and the film wouldn't be what it is without Geiger's monster design. Truly monstrous, and it lives up to the name of the film. It's totally alien, unlike anything anyone's ever seen before. The film is full of standout moments. It's movie-making at its best. Ridley Scott's second film might be his best, and it's astonishing that after this he directed another sci-fi masterpiece in Blade Runner. A film called Alien, about a monster, you know, some guy in a suit, killing people on a spaceship, could have easily been crap or just a piece of silly nonsense, but with this crew and cast, Alien is a triumph of cinema. Right, so counting down my top 20. In a number 20, Mad Max. In a number 19, The Muppet Movie. In a number 18, Vengeance is Mine. In a number 17, Phantasm. In a number 16, The Jerk. In a number 15, Stalker. In a number 14, Kramer vs. Kramer. In a number 13, 10. In a number 12, The Warriors. In a number 11, Camera Buff. In a number 10, Quadrophenia. In a number 9, Heartland. In a number 8, Scum. In a number 7, Breaking Away. In a number 6, Monty Python's Life of Brian. In a number 5, Manhattan. In a number 4, Being There. In a number 3, All That Jazz. In a number 2, Apocalypse Now. And in a number 1, Alien. Well, those are my top 20 films of 1979. It was a great year for cinema, and there's probably loads I've missed off. So what are your top 20 films of 1979? Cheers.